poetry at the Dodge Poetry Festival.
In Paris, one of the sports is to watch people and to be watched. And it's not impolite to stare. And the people who bear up under the pressure of a gaze the best, are, I think, are the women from the islands, the former French colonies, from Martinique, Guadeloupe. The island women of Paris skim from curb to curb like regatta, from Pointe Neuf to the Quai de la Rappe, in cool negotiation with traffic, each a country to herself, transposed to this city by a fluke called imperial courtesy. The island women glide past, held aloft by a wire running straight to heaven. Who can ignore their ornamental bearing, turbans haughty as parrots, or deft braids carved into airy cages transfixed on their manifest brows? The island women move through Paris as if they had just finished inventing their destinations. It's better not to get in their way, and better not look an island woman in the eye, unless you like feeling unnecessary. And I'll, thank you. I will, thank you. And I'll close with a poem about my daughter. At the time of the writing of this poem, she was extremely young. Those first magical 2 or 3 weeks when a child, it looks like, remembers where they've been, and it's only after about 10 days or so when they, with great melancholy, I think, they begin to look at the world and say, this place is not going away, I better get used to it. The breathing, the endless news. Every god is lonely, an exile composed of parts, elk horn, cloven hoof. Receptacle for wishes, each god is empty without us, penitent, raking our yards into windblown piles. Children know this. They are the trailings of gods. Their eyes hold nothing at birth, then fill slowly with the myth of ourselves. Not so their dolls, out for the count, each toe pouting from the slumped over toddler clothes, no blossoming there. So we give our children dolls, and they know just what to do, line them up and shoot them. With every execution, doll and god grow stronger. Thank you.
Poet Rita Dove, reading in the 10 Amphitheater at the Dodge Poetry Festival. Here, a daughter writes about her mother. Lucille Clifton's poem is called Fury.
I was riding in a car, and I was thinking about the word fury. You know, you ride around and a word gets in your head. And I was thinking, well, I don't know if I know. I know rage, and I know anger, and I know all that, but I don't know if I knew fury. And then it occurred to me that I did know. I have seen fury. My mother used to write poems. She wrote iambic pentameter verse, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. That was my mother's poem. And neither of my parents graduated from elementary school. My father couldn't write. They were both great readers, great lovers of books. And once my mother, I don't know the circumstance, but she got a letter from somebody wanting to publish a poem. And my father said, and now this was not because he was a mean man, it was because it was 1940-something, and husbands thought they could do this sort of thing. My father said, no wife of mine will be a poetry writer. And so my mother went down into the, we had a coal stove, and she went down and threw her poems into the stove. And I was standing on the steps, and I watched her. Fury for Mama. Remember this. She is standing by the furnace. The coals glisten like rubies. Her hand is crying. Her hand is clutching a sheaf of papers, poems. She gives them up. They burn jewels into jewels. Each hank of her hair is a serpent's obedient wife. She will never recover. Remember, there is nothing you will not bear for this woman's sake.
Lucille Clifton has written 7 volumes of poetry and is an award-winning author of children's books. She teaches at St. Mary's College in Maryland. As poet Maxine Cumin says, Lucille Clifton celebrates for all of us her race, her quintessentially female, fierce, creative selfhood. WHYY Arts reporter Melinda Whiting talked with Lucille Clifton at the Dodge Poetry Festival.
What effect did it have on you to see your mother burn her work like that?
Well, I think that the poem about that ends, "There is nothing I will not bear for this woman's sake." And I had some resolve that what I was doing, I understood that what I was trying to do in writing, now I didn't think about publishing, that wasn't what I was thinking about, but in writing and continuing to write, and I was writing for over 20 years before I was published, I had the resolve that I was going to do this, that nobody was going to say, I could not do this. I was saying to somebody earlier today that I am not good at directions, including taking them. And nobody was going to define for me what I could or could not be.
I'd like to ask you to read another poem, mm-hmm. What the Mirror Said.
Oh. I wanted to write that not only because I'm a luxury-sized woman, but because I was older than some new cars, right? What the Mirror Said, and this is the mirror talking to me, getting up in the morning, looking in the mirror, and having to get through the day anyway. Listen, you a wonder. You a city of a woman. You got a geography of your own. Listen, somebody need a map to understand you. Somebody need directions to move around you. Listen, woman, you not a no-place anonymous girl. Mister with his hands on you, he got his hands on some damn body. That's fun.
I love your term, luxury-sized woman.
I am the Cadillac of females. I am a limousine of my own. I am. And you see, those things are valuable in this culture. I say quite a lot, why do people want all this big stuff and the teeny little women? I just don't understand it. That shows the hypocrisy of everything. Some days I think it shows we're really in hell or something, I don't know.
Well, it's certainly true that, at least in this culture, a lot of women don't love their bodies.
Mm-hmm.
And what I hear in this poem is the voice of a woman or a mirror that loves that power
I
and
like
that mystery.
To praise myself as I am. I like to praise women and women's bodies. Someone asked me, I have a poem about menstruation, and someone asked me this afternoon, what do men do when I read that? Do I read it in front of men, first of all? What do I ask? All the men should leave the room. And what do they do when I read it? And the question came out of some strange idea that there are some things not suitable for males to hear, or there are some things that we are embarrassed about. And I was saying that I cannot understand being embarrassed about the human functions of human women. And men who don't know about it should be taught, you know.
Do they have a hard time understanding at first what you're talking about?
Who, men or women?
Men.
No. The most interesting thing a guy said to me, because I read it then, this afternoon, and the guys were chuckling in the audience and looking over to be sure that the woman they were with approved of their chuckling, I think. One guy did come up to me. One of the lines is something about, this is a poem called Wishes for Sons. I wish you...
Here it is.
Oh, I'll read. All right.
And I've been thinking about it as you've been talking.
Wishes for Sons. This is a poem that I say, and I think it's true. I doubt if there's a woman over 12 who has not thought this. I doubt very seriously. Wishes for sons. I wish them cramps. I wish them a strange gown and the last tampon. I wish them no 7-Eleven. I wish them 1 week early and wearing a white skirt.
I wish them 1 week late. Later, I wish them hot flashes and clots like you wouldn't believe. Let the flashes come when they meet someone special. Let the clots come when they want to. Let them think they have accepted arrogance in the universe. Then bring them to gynecologists, not unlike themselves. Now, a young man said to me once, he said, Mrs. Clifton, could I talk to you a minute privately? And I said, sure. And he said, I am the only son. I went to an all-male school. I'm 19. Can you be late? And I assured him that one could be late, and this was very important information for a young man of 19 to have. He said, I had no idea. And so I felt myself useful in the world, actually. I have helped this boy.
I think if there's one word for the poems of yours that are very much about female experiences, it wouldn't be feminist so much as a sort of inclusiveness, or a... not throwing up a barrier and saying this is for women, but this is about us. This is about human beings.
Being human, I hope so. But feminist, you remember, is a word that depends on the person who's defining it. People ask me, somebody said to me, I was in, where was I? Bisbee, Arizona, actually. Oh, I shouldn't have pinpointed it, but anyway.
And
they
looked
at me and said, you're in Ms. Magazine sometimes. I said, yes, I am. And she said, I like you. You're a feminist, aren't you? And I said, well, you have to tell me what that means. And you tell me what you mean when you say it, and I will tell you if I am one of those. And she was thrown. And finally she said, well, I guess it's somebody who likes women. I said, well, then I am one. Yes, I like women, and I like men. People put labels on things. That doesn't mean that the thing is the label, you know? And when I say something, I know what I mean by that. If it means that I think that women are also humans and ought to receive human respect and their due, our due, I absolutely do think that, yes.
I come from a town and I come from a place where people don't read a whole lot. But people speak poetry constantly.
Elizabeth Woody is a Native American poet of Navajo and Yakima ancestry from Portland, Oregon. For centuries, Navajo, as well as Cheyenne and Abenaki and other Native American languages, existed only in the oral tradition. Poet and storyteller Joseph Bruchac explains that for this reason, Native Americans regard the word as alive, not just as syllables and symbols. Now poets such as Elizabeth Woody, Lance Henson, Joseph Bruchac, and Rex Lee Jim are writing down the stories and poetry of their people. Their poems explore the relationship between a personal and a cultural identity. Rex Lee Jim is a Navajo who teaches in Rock Point, Arizona. Here he introduces himself to a Dodge Festival audience by talking about his ancestors.
I belong to the Kintlicheetni clan, the Red House clan. My paternal grandfather belongs to the Wandering People, or the Mexican clan. And my maternal grandfather belongs to the Towering House clan, one of the four original Navajo clans. Normally in Navajo, we introduce ourselves this way because we have a clanship structure which determines whether you've met the person or not. You end up being related to them.
Translation. Where I am, to the east, to the west, to the south, to the north, to the center of the earth, to the center of the sky, from the east, from the west, from the south, from the north, from the center of the earth, from the center of the sky. Here in this place I am, here in this time I am, now I am. I have come to know myself. I have come to know my place.
I remember little fingernail. I remember crazy horse. I remember sweet medicine. Hina hane, mahako tomiots, hitome toneo, ihiwo.
Cheyenne poet Lance Henson.
I'm a maker of Cheyenne songs. These songs belong to my family, and in time, as the tribe progresses into the 20th and 21st centuries, the songs that I've made for my family will be sung when the family is honored at dances. This is one of them. It's a dog soldier song. Dusat nimadutschon maka migis nahatni. Dusat nimadutschon mahako. Iwutsta nihibiyo maif maheo ihiwo. Iwutsta nihibiyo maif. Where is the spirit of eagle and wolf? Where is the spirit of badger? They are living in your blood, all Creator says. They are living in your blood. The whirlwind, which is the tamer relative of the tornado, is, of course, the closest relative to the Cheyenne. Its hollow eye is the eye of an ancestor raised up from the wind and the earth to tell us of the presence of the creative spirit in all things. Leaving bent sport for Floyd bringing good. Riding the high plains from Colorado to Kansas, a whirlwind gaunt and alone crosses the landscape. I drive the truck south toward Oklahoma, crossing the same path Two Moon and Roman Nose once wandered. I am on the edge, barely in America, somewhere between rage and freedom.
Lance Henson. Joseph Brushak is a poet and storyteller of Abenaki, English, and Slovak ancestry. He's helping to revive the sacred oral tradition in Native American poetry.
Part of my ancestry is European, and I feel a great deal of pain when I see what is happening in much of Europe now. In 1989, I traveled to Germany. I was in West Germany. And when I wrote this poem, it had a different meaning for me then than it does for me now. It's called Crossing into West Germany. There are borders on earth and lines on the maps, colors and barriers, human names stuck onto soil as if earth could claim to understand or speak our tongues. As if the hawks looking down in long flight saw nations and flags, not forests and valleys, places to live, hunt, care for their young. But the wind still blows over every border, and the soil that sifts through the hands of farmers responds the same to drought and rain. Ask me now to which nation I belong, and I will answer without words in a song. That language all our ancestors spoke, learned from the flow of clear streams to the sea, birds chanting praise to each dawn. One more short poem, because we like to do things in fours, for the four directions, the four seasons, our four grandparents. This is called Ndakina, which means our land in Abenaki. Ndakina, that's what we call America. Ndakina, you cannot understand this land with maps. Lines drawn as if earth were an animal's carcass, cut into pieces, skinned, though always less eaten than thrown away. See this land instead with a wind eagle's eyes, linked with rivers and streams like sinew through leather, sewed strong to hold the people to the earth. Do not try to know the land by roads. Let your feet instead caress the soil in the way of deer, whose trails follow the ways of least resistance. When you feel this land, when you taste this land, when you hold this land as lungs hold breath, when your songs see this land, when your ears sing this land, You will be this land. You will be this land. Thank you.
In this writing workshop with Native American poets, Joseph Bruschak cautions against cultural stereotyping.
Not every person of Native ancestry knows how to sing or dance or be spiritual. But it is true that the cultures most of us come from were cultures that had a language and traditions which celebrated continuity, connection, family values, and all life. Lance is quite right when he says the English language is a language full of bias. Just the fact that we have personal pronouns divided into he and she, whereas in Abenaki, there's only one word, agama, which means either he or she. And it shows in the poetry that is written. The poetry that is written in English by people who are described as American Indian or Native American is very, very often a poetry that deals with both that bitter heritage of continuing colonialism and that celebratory heritage of balance and harmony and healing and, yes, laughter. Some of the funniest poems I have ever read in my life have been written by Native people, especially Native elders. I think, for example, of a poem written by an old man who was a teacher of mine, a man named Lewis Oliver, talking about a couple of Indian guys in a bar. It's called Indian Macho, and it describes how these two men are trying to impress a woman. Each one's doing one thing more impressive than the other. Finally, one guy takes a $50 bill and tears it up, burns it. But the narrator of the poem writes a check for $10,000 and tears that up, and the woman says, "You go home with me."
Joseph Bruschak. Elizabeth Woody is a Native American of Navajo ancestry from Portland, Oregon. Her poems give voice to the silent past and present of Native Americans living as exiles in their own land.
I am a dress of vermilion, harvest of orange roses, a Sunday visit, not a descendant today, strolling to the petroglyphs, agog, lalal. A family of five stare. They stumble over the rocks, video cam in hand, screaming, "Oh my God, oh my God." I am only a dress in a state of being true. They hope to converse. Exhibit. I lay on the illusion of verdant environment at Horse Thief Lake Park, surrounded by the vermil of copper drought, built over the site of a nameless wishram village. The illusion is that there are no wishram. I ponder with affection the sky and poplar trees. The assurance and comfort move the tension in my spine, slowly loosening to say I am where I most belong at the moment. Families move about my body in the usual manner, chatter, ignore my incongruous presence, distribute their food, consume. The village. This is my village. Of vicarious backgrounds, the new river people who are brown and white. In living diorama, they are as poor from the loss of land hauled out piece by piece as lumber, salmon, and fruit. The children, all brown as potatoes, round-tummied with a dimple of their navels pointing ahead, run into the shallows, twirl like fish lures, oblivious of dispossession. Water skippers are quaint shadows at the edge of calm water. Willows break for paths. Birds are busy with delicate manners. Their feet are so bare, beaks, tiny bone needles, their eyes rimmed with endearing vulnerability.
Elizabeth Woody reading from her work in progress, Luminaries of the Humble, during an evening program at the Dodge Festival.
A
it's an irreplaceable art, poetry. It's the art in which a person says in his or her own voice what it is to live on earth.
Writing about the beauty of the natural world is an ancient tradition. Poems about the things of this earth, the trees, the oceans, the sunlight, and the sky, evoke universal emotions. W.S. Merwin says that language is the vessel of our humanity. It renews our connection to the earth and embodies the possibilities of the future. In a workshop session on poetry and the earth, Galway Connell expands on this interpretation of poetry's mission and its origins. He says that poetry has always played a part in restoring our relationship with nature.
I'd just like to say that, speak a word about the what is often supposed to be the origin of poetry. When agriculture began and the humans scratched the Mother Earth, then the nature religion sprang up, which took place in chanted speech, i.e. in poetry. The reason for the poetry was to ask forgiveness of Mother Earth and to restore harmony between us and the Earth. And in some way, that's been a major function of poetry ever since.
Poet W.S. Merwin.
I began writing as soon as I could write anything.
Yeah.
You know? Although I think the first things I wrote were, my father was a minister and I wrote hymns because I thought that would get, you know, that was a good thing to write. It was the only kind of poetry I knew, in fact. But I've been touched by these terrible, pious, platitudinous things. But once it seemed to be really something that I wanted to do, when I went after puberty, and you know, after the world of sex and all of that began to open up, which is when I think it really happens. But suddenly, I think the thing that struck me, and it's what happens, I think, as the erotic life begins, suddenly looking at the light and looking at the seasons and looking at what happened in the season and recognizing that it was going, that it was this, I was seeing this only once, and what could I do with it, and trying to write about that. That was where I began to write, and I suppose everyone stops trying to write about that. That's it.
W.S. Merwin ranks with Stanley Kunitz and Galway Connell as one of the foremost poets writing today. Since he published his first book in 1952, A Mask for Janus, he has received the Pulitzer Prize for Poetry, the Bollingen Prize, and the Fellowship of the Academy of American Poets. Merwin describes art as a matter of making connections. In this next poem, he links the course of one writer's life with the destruction of nature. It's called Cord.
While Keats wrote, they were cutting down the sandalwood forests. While he listened to the nightingale, they heard their own axes echoing through the forests. While he sat in the walled garden on the hill outside the city, they thought of their gardens dying far away on the mountain. While the sound of the words clawed at him, they thought of their wives. While the tip of his pen traveled, the iron they had coveted was hateful to them. While he thought of the Grecian woods, they bled under red flowers. While he dreamed of wine, the trees were falling from the trees. While he felt his heart, they were hungry and their faith was sick. While the song broke over him, they were in a secret place and they were cutting it forever. While he coughed, they carried the trunks to the hole in the forest the size of a foreign ship. While he groaned on the voyage to Italy, they fell on the trails and were broken. When he lay with the odes behind him, the wood was sold for cannons. When he lay watching the window, they came home and lay down. And an age arrived when everything was explained in another language.
W.S. Merwin reading his poem, Cord. Galway Connell's most recent book is called When One Has Lived a Long Time Alone. In his poetry, Connell often explores the relationship between ourselves and nature. Here he responds to a question from a member of a workshop audience.
The earth is not in trouble due to the stones and the trees and so forth. The earth is in trouble due to the human being. We are the dangerous species. So there's no possibility of saving the earth by finding out what neurosis the elm tree has. We have to find out what's wrong with the human being. Therefore, poems about the human being are not unconnected with the fate of the earth.
Galway Connell, reading from his poem, Sheffield Pastorals.
Desire and act were once a combination known as sin. The old teachings regarding the evils of the flesh sometimes caused flesh to peel and shred away. A deathbed repentance intended to get rid of one bright and terrible thread can end up unraveling an entire lifetime. Fishes are the holy land of the sea. In them, spirit is flesh, flesh is spirit, the brain simply a denser place in the flesh. The human brain is the brightest place on earth. At death, the body becomes foreign substance. We wash it, dress it, and embrace the memory in it, but somewhere else knows it and welcomes it. Thank you.
Elizabeth Woody is a Navajo Wasco Warm Springs Indian. She lives in Portland, Oregon, and is one of the main organizers of Native American writers in the Northwest. Here she reads from her book, Hand into Stone, and from an unpublished collection to be called Reinventing Ourselves in the Enemy's Language.
Well, thank you all for being here. I really mean that. It's a very special occasion that you have here, that you've generated here for poetry. My book, Hand into Stone, has as its more or less its centerpiece or its center stone, a poem called Hand into Stone. And I begin it with a quote that is taken from one of my conversations, one of my many conversations with my grandmother. And her, what she had said struck me so much, I wrote it down, and then the poem came afterwards. Someday the land will be our eyes and skin again. For a lot of years, she prepared my sister and I, my younger sister and I, because my grandparents raised us for, and my grandfather preceded her in death, for her eventual death. And she told us that we all go back into the land, and that she had come to terms with loneliness by feeling that all our relatives were in the land, and that there was no place we could not go that did not have some relationship. So I took that and used another image that's maybe particular to the Northwest because of the volcanic activity is a geode. You've seen them as thunder eggs. They cut them in half and there's little crystals in the middle. And when I was tanning hides one summer with an older lady, she told me, she goes, you know, it's real interesting that all these Chiapos, they cut this little stone in half, but you know, I was told that these little stones hold spirits. And I just wonder what all those spirits are doing. So, and that's kind of one of the symbols, okay? And another thing is that sleeping with my grandmother, I thought was an honor to be under her protection, under the covers. And that is kind of more or less about what this poem's about. Her craped fingers, teeth marked with red speckles, held mine tight as she showed our finger moons to me. They grew together as snowy stones, scratching themselves sleepily. She had long fingers with the mobility of spiders. I felt them at night as they climbed my skin. She wrapped us in tight shells with agate crystals. We breathed in our own breath under this cover. The piece that begins the second section of the book, the first section is she, the first section is titled differently, but the second section is called She Walks Across This Country. In the first section, she walks across, walks along the river. And one of the things that happened to me when I left the reservation where I lived a part of my life, not all of it, was having to live in houses that weren't of my own making or my own design. And I thought about it in that people's houses, Indian people's houses, and people's houses in cultures that are very much closer to the land have circular ones, or ones that don't take you away from the environment. But also, having to live in extremely close proximity to people who have no knowledge of one another was a different experience. So this is called scratch medicine and tenements. In this house, the regal apparition is the headdress on the bureau, a reminder of well-dressed whims. Your wing is in place beside the bird, content on the escape outside, a restful pose of enacted circles. The flight northward, the whoosh southward. Between the breasts is a silver star haloing circumferences, a hut arm, bite of old aches and simulated lines of fortune on the palms. This is the warm, moist place of eyes in the heart, quick and squinting in light, too harsh for night cats. The door is broken again from drunks bursting forth and inward, splattered with acid, the walls evidence batteries and disintegration of entities. My edgeful certainty is marked boundaries of graffiti, spiral laments of tomcat heads ripped of ears nestles into this house of delirium, with hairs between the fingers and tastes of brine, old hides and horse breath. Under a sad tongue, there is a gasp of air, a fast ride over stoniness. The tremble of prediction is recovery of the past, not a past, but the burning of old houses, tar-papered shacks, and poisoned blankets laced with smallpox. Our hair touches in the dirt and has remained that way as thoughts. Evocative night calls, birds in the shimmer of naked trees push against the slant of winter and drought. Without this peace, there is a scratch of the lost stray, the wildcat of hard-bitten tidbits of remedy. The only way back is by the direction formed in the flowering strips of grandmother's dress encircling our limbs.
Poet Lucille Clifton.
The earth is a living thing, is a black shambling bear, ruffling its wild back and tossing mountains into the sea, is a black hawk circling the burying ground, circling the bones picked clean and discarded, is a fish black blind in the belly of water, is a diamond blind in the black belly of coal, is a black and living thing, is a favorite child of the universe. Feel her rolling her hand in its kinky hair. Feel her brushing it clean.
As Lucille Clifton says, to write is to imagine oneself into another reality. With an integrity and power that draws out what is pure and strong and true in the human heart. There are many poets in the world, some known by name, others not. They're people of every age, culture, and nationality. Here are some voices from formal and informal readings at this gathering of poets in Waterloo, New Jersey.
This one is called I Dreamed That I Was Old. I dreamed that I was old. In stale declension, fallen from my prime, when company was mine, cat nimbleness and green invention, before time took my leafy hours away. My wisdom, ripe with body's ruin, found itself tart recompense for what was lost in false exchange, since wisdom in the ground has no apocalypse or Pentecost. I wept for my youth, sweet, passionate young thought, and cozy women dead that by my side once lay. I wept with bitter longing, not remembering how in my youth I cried.
Hi, my name is Joshua Roberts. I'll be reading a poem called The Portrait by Stanley Kunitz. The Portrait. My mother never forgave my father for killing himself, especially at such an awkward time and in a public park that spring when I was waiting to be born. She locked his name in her deepest cabinet.
She locked his name in her deepest cabinet and would not let him out, though I could hear him thumping. When I came down from the attic with the pastel portrait in my hand of a long-lipped stranger with a brave mustache and deep brown level eyes, she ripped it into shreds without a single word and slapped me hard. In my 64th year, I can feel my cheek still burning.
All my friends are exiles. Born in one place, we live in another, and with true sophistication, rendezvous in places, most surprising places, where you would never expect to find us. Between us, we people the world with aplomb and a command of languages. We stride across continents with the self-assurance of those who know with absolute certainty where they come from. With the globe at our command, we have everywhere to go but home.
Mixed blessings for Tony McNeil. They asked McNeil to eulogize his aunt. After all, he was the poet in the family. And when he said unbecoming things, they were shocked down to the grave, and some exploded with laughter. And the Anglican priest and the acolyte boy allergic to flowers waited, and the old caretaker down by the gate jingled his ring full of keys. And the woman in white who led the procession wailed, and blossoms of frangipani fell on them. And still McNeil droned on and on in that voice of his about his aunt's madness and decline, while her casket sat upon the brink and the oval glass grew cloudy as if she had resumed breathing. And the men with shovels clinked and lit up and smoked again. And when the cannon signal finally caught his eye, McNeil read one last verse about there being no end to wickedness and closed the book, nearly tripping on one of the lowering ropes as someone said amen and they let her down quickly.
I love it. I love it. We are all weird. I think we all do have these feelings of alienation. We feel we're incapable of love, that no one really loves. If they really knew us, they wouldn't love us. I think we all experience these feelings. And art is something we need. It's not just something pleasing and decorative. It is the stuff of life. It's a matter of life and death.
Poet Jane Kenyon.
Let the light of late afternoon shine through chinks in the barn, moving up the bales as the sun moves down. Let the cricket take up chafing as a woman takes up her needles and her yarn. Let evening come. Let dew collect on the hoe abandoned in long grass. Let the stars appear and the moon disclose her silver horn. Let the fox go back to its sandy den. Let the wind die down. Let the shed go black inside. Let evening come. To the bottle in the ditch, to the scoop in the oats, to air in the lung, let evening come. Let it come as it will, and don't be afraid. God does not leave us comfortless, so let evening come.
Jane Kenyon reading the title poem from her book, Let Evening Come.
I do think that poetry, you know, is a great art and can say so much, but there's a point at which language can't encompass everything.
A Galway canal.
Sometimes, I don't know if I've ever reached that point, you see, in my poetry, but I've read some great poems, and when I come to the end of them, I feel there's more to be said, and that Mozart should take over at that point, you know. There's just some soaring that language can do.
Galway Canal, Sharon Olds, and Lucille Clifton ended a workshop session by reading in unison from a poem by William Butler Yeats called A Dialogue of Self and Soul.
I am content to follow to its source every event in action or in thought, measure the lot, forgive myself the lot. When such as I cast out remorse, so great a sweetness flows into the breast, we must laugh and we must sing. We are blessed by...